Go ahead, Mr. Barrett.
What we see often from government, this Liberal government, this NDP-Liberal government, is that they try and take every opportunity to avoid accountability and reasonable and fair criticism of their failures. And on Mr. Bain's motion, I didn't hear, preamble or his justification, I didn't hear the falsehood that he said was made against him, nor evidence that anything that was said or repeated by my colleague, that it was incorrect. And this is the pattern. And the irony, of course, is that they're saying, Mr. Baines and the NDP Liberal government are saying that it's intimidation if they hope to move a motion that someone else moves a motion that speaks to a different issue that's critical of them, well, that's intimidation. But they have a motion that, without any evidence, they've put forward to attempt to censure an opposition MP, but that's not intimidation. As if any time, and we heard in the most bizarre terms at the last meeting, a Liberal member say that by simply referencing the behavior of another MP, that it's inciting hate. But that same MP, in the 7 days before, tweeted out, named every Conservative member of this committee looking to engage social media users to reach out to those MPs. Members of Parliament must be accountable to Canadians. And to have the NDP Liberal government try and take a situation like this, which let's just be very black and white. Mr. Brock was recognized by the chair of the committee. He had the floor, and he appropriately moved a motion. And the allegation by Mr. Baines is that, oh, that's an intimidation. That's an attempt to try and silence him from doing his job. This is obviously an attempt by Mr. Baines. It's a vexatious motion to try and silence someone who's rightly critical of the government. A great example of the situation we're facing in this country this week and the lack of seriousness by parties in the House with respect to foreign interference. We have the government put forward a bill to finally take some steps to address foreign interference in our democratic institutions, like has been alleged in Steveston Richmond East, Mr. Baines' riding, in the last election. And the official opposition put forward a motion in the House to fast-track the bill so that it could be passed, because we've heard from security officials that it's going to take them up to a year and a half to fully implement this bill, the provisions of this bill. And the NDP withheld consent. They blocked the expeditious passage of legislation to address foreign interference in our democracy. So there's a lot of big questions about the motivations of people, of members of parties, with respect to serious issues. And it seems like an attempt to control the narrative on what's okay to talk about on foreign interference and what's not okay to talk about on foreign interference. How can we as parliamentarians talk about foreign interference in our elections if we can't talk about allegations of interference in our election in specific ridings. How can we do that? How can we hear testimony from witnesses on foreign interference when they allege that there were attempts to interfere in their election by foreign state actors, and that person comes and testifies, and then a member repeats that evidence, repeats those allegations, and the individual who's alleged to be a beneficiary of those attempts or of those alleged actions then says, well, you're attempting to intimidate me by talking about the evidence that we're hearing on a study that the committee has asked to have. I would note that this is now the second meeting where the published notice of meeting had in-camera consideration of a draft report listed, and the committee is not dealing with that. Interestingly, because that study is also critical of government departments. And we see this time and time again, that there are attempts to block the scrutiny of the government that's put on them by the official opposition. Official opposition. Well, it's in the name. Our job is to be the check against the balance of power. And after 9 years of this NDP-Liberal government, we see that we have a government that is the least transparent in history. And they use every tool to try and silence their critics. Every time there's a criticism of the government, there's an attempt to deflect from it. A government that, you know, spends $1.3 million on so-called affordability retreats. Oh, well, we don't want to talk about that. Let's talk about people who talked about evidence at committee instead. You know, this government that is presiding over a cost of living crisis. The coalition government that's refusing to expeditiously pass legislation to combat foreign interference. Fights tooth and nail to block scrutiny of ministers like Minister Boissonneau and his business associates, Mr. Anderson and Ms. Poon, who are supposed to be here Tuesday. Well, we haven't got through the business of this committee at the last two meetings. I get the suspicion that there's an attempt to block the work of members to scrutinize Minister Boissonneau's actions. That's the tactic that we're seeing from the NDP Liberal government. And it's interesting that the request is for an apology. I don't need to ask Mr. Brock if that ask was made to him discreetly or in good faith by members opposite before they jumped up on the soapbox, because I know they didn't, because it wasn't an attempt to solicit an apology. It's an attempt to silence criticism of a corrupt government. A prime minister twice found guilty himself of breaking ethics laws. And criticism of a government being deflected by the tactics, like we saw at the last meeting, that descended into, I believe, intentional chaos by members of the NDP Liberal government. We know, it is a fact that there was a misinformation campaign that targeted the riding of Steveston, Richmond East. Well, who was the intended beneficiary of that? Well, these questions are huge. We have a commission looking into these questions. Not because the member for Brantford-Brant was looking to silence the member for Steveston-Richmond East. It's because this is a matter of national concern that has also alarmed our international allies. The global community is watching. We used to be asked to go and monitor elections in other countries. What's happening in this country compromises our ability to be a beacon of democracy elsewhere if we don't take it seriously. But we see intimidation attempts by the government to try and silence critics and to try and silence parliamentary opposition. Are we able to talk about the Chinese Canadians and Uyghurs who are terrorized by the CCP? Are we allowed to share their experience? Or is that an attempt to silence a government who has been alleged to be the beneficiary of foreign interference by the communist dictatorship in Beijing? Well, some of their members might have been elected because of it, and therefore their members would be, could be intimidated by that discussion. So we can't talk about it. It's preposterous. It's preposterous. We've seen a warm hand, well beyond a wink and a nudge, for the dictatorship in Beijing by Justin Trudeau. Justin Trudeau even said he admired their basic dictatorship. His words, not mine. And I appreciate that by quoting someone else's words in context, that I might hear that I've jeopardized the Prime Minister's parliamentary privilege by being critical. That's my job. And that's our job. And talking about what happens here is part of it's that that's our job. It's not as if we haven't seen examples from the government before where they've tried to do exactly what they're doing right now. Justin Trudeau is guilty of contravening Sections 5, 11, 12, and 21 of the Conflict of Interest Act. And when we attempt to address these issues at this committee, we have seen extraordinary filibusters. Extraordinary. Weeks. Weeks on end. The Prime Minister was further found guilty of contravening Section 9 of the Conflict of Interest Act for politically interfering in the criminal prosecution of SNC-Lavalin. Now, that's a company that was charged with fraud and corruption for bribing Libyan officials of the Gaddafi regime. $48 million in bribes, defrauding Libyans, Libyan organizations out of $130 million. And when we've attempted to scrutinize why there weren't criminal sanctions when we know, we've seen the evidence from the RCMP that there was a decision tree, for example, in the case of the Trudeau Report 1, a decision tree that showed that for the Prime Minister to have been able to take a trip to Billionaire Island, the first time that he had the series of findings of guilt against him for breaking the Conflict of Interest Act. The only question in the RCMP decision tree on whether or not the Prime Minister could reasonably be, there's a reasonable prospect of conviction for fraud on government, because he accepted a gift worth hundreds of thousands of dollars from an individual who was the beneficiary of millions of dollars in grants from the government. And the Prime Minister has, of course, the only question that was left outstanding was whether or not the Prime Minister had received permission in writing from the head of the branch of government for which he worked. The Prime Minister admitted in the House that he did not, in fact, have that criteria satisfied. And so by the RCMP's own analysis, there was a reasonable prospect of conviction against Justin Trudeau for the relevant criminal code offenses. And we had the RCMP commissioner at the table, and we had the cover-up coalition move to adjourn the meeting.
Yes.
Well, is that not a breach of the privileges of members of the official opposition who are trying to do their job? Isn't the commissioner of the RCMP sitting at the table, and they adjourned the meeting? Proper notice given for the meeting. The meeting was set in accordance and complying with all of the standing orders and usual practices of the House of Commons. Does that not rise to the same level of in a meeting discussing evidence that was given about matters that are before the committee? I've heard great umbrage taken by members of the NDP-Liberal government when we talk about them covering up corruption by their government. Oh, you can't say that. They claim. And if you do say it, my goodness, they're going to try and make sure that people don't hear about it. Shut down the meetings. I think it was 2 weeks ago. We had the law clerk and an officer of parliament sitting in the room, ready to give testimony, but it wasn't flattering to the government. What happened? Meeting adjourned. This is a pattern that we see, just like this motion from Mr. Baines. Anything that resembles criticism of the government or doesn't match their narrative is not acceptable. And the official opposition isn't going to be deterred by efforts of this coalition to... We have to hold them to account. We must expose this government when it fails Canadians. I'd put it that way, when it fails Canadians, as it has in so many instances. You know, we've addressed at this committee, and this is another example of the tactics, like the one that we're seeing in this motion, being used to block criticism of the government and its members, including members of the executive, with their $60 million arrive scam. And the transparency that we look to apply is met with fierce opposition from the government. We were told in 2022, there's nothing to see here, it all worked fine, but we can't tell you who did the work, and we won't tell you how much it cost. And every Liberal member of Parliament, every member of Cabinet, voted against having the Auditor General investigate. Well, wait a second. Is that by the same standard that Mr. Baines is looking to set with this motion? Is disagreeing with the government, is that a violation of the privilege of the members of Parliament who voted for the Auditor General to look into what has been demonstrated to be a massive scandal for the Trudeau government? We see grifters who are skimming 30% on contracts worth tens of millions of dollars, but adding no value to that work. Had the government had their way and not allowed us to do our work, and not allowed us to engage the parliamentary tools that are available to us, like the Office of the Auditor General, like the Office of the Procurement Ombudsman, then we wouldn't have the information we have about how broken the systems have become after 9 years of Justin Trudeau and his NDP-Liberal government. So asking questions and putting forward motions, like Mr. Brock put forward appropriately at the meeting, motion that was in order, and I don't have a copy of the Blues in front of me to read back as evidence Mr. Brock's statements from that meeting, but I'll be interested to hear from the mover of the motion, Mr. Baines, where's the lie? That's what I want to hear. I'm interested to hear, and I would have expected that in his litigation of this question, of his explanation of the necessity of this, why we're not dealing with the business of the committee. What was it that Mr. Brock said that wasn't true? And my further question would be, when Mr. Baines, should he choose to entertain the question, is what efforts did he take if he's looking for an apology? Instead of spending hours of committee time to solicit an apology, did he ask for one and then was denied and then looked to escalate it? But this isn't about that. This is about looking to create a distraction from his government that's in crisis. And we continue to see examples of that. The billion-dollar green slush fund is another prime example where after the government is challenged for their mismanagement of the file, you know, we hear from the minister, he says, well, you know, we took reasonable steps, and as soon as we found out, we took reasonable steps, and we're going to restore governance, and it's all been very reasonable. The Liberal handpicked chair and another member are both being investigated by the Ethics Commissioner because I had to refer the matter to the Ethics Commissioner's office. Their chair resigned in disgrace. You would think that if the minister had it in hand, that he would have taken some steps, fired the chair. But every time we raise issues like their billion-dollar green slush fund. Oh, and one of the individuals who voted in the self-dealing way to enrich companies that they had an interest in, to the tune of, you know, tens of millions of dollars, they appointed one of those individuals to the infrastructure bank. And I asked the infrastructure minister the other day, and when I asked, he said, "Oh, I don't know about." I don't know about that individual. And then when I pressed him about whether that individual should be serving on the infrastructure board, the most transparent, the government that claimed they would be the most transparent in history, his deputy leans over to him and says, oh, they resigned, that individual resigned in April, weeks ago. Well, I encourage you to take a scan of the Infrastructure Bank's website for that announcement. It's not there. But at every turn that there's accountability demanded of this NDP Liberal government, there are extraordinary steps to make sure that they aren't held to account. And you'll hear when we say you know, we talk about their legacy after 9 years, and the response is, oh, well, you think we're bad. You should have seen the last guys. Like, they still want to talk about a previous government as if the legacy that they've presided over isn't that they don't own it, that they're just they're victims. We've heard a lot lately that whenever, you know, things are pretty bad, and when they find out who's in charge, they're really going to give it to them. The call is coming from inside the House. And the opposition, the official opposition at least, put forward motions and propose measures that are in line with our role to hold them accountable, to hold the NDP-Liberal government accountable. But with this motion from Mr. Baines, it calls for it pronounces on falsehoods without saying what they are, and I'll reference the text of the motion exactly. False and defamatory statements. Well, it just wants members, on the word of the member for Steveston Richmond East, on the word of Mr. Baines, just let's just assume that everything that the Conservative member said was false and misleading, and he should apologize for all of it. There's no list. He doesn't itemize his what he claims to be false, and he doesn't detail evidence to the contrary. And I think that that's quite telling. I think it's quite telling. We further saw at this committee when the trade minister, Minister Ng, had been found guilty of breaking ethics laws, like Justin Trudeau was found guilty of breaking ethics laws, like Minister Bill Morneau was found guilty of breaking ethics laws, like Minister Dominic LeBlanc was found guilty of breaking ethics laws, like Liberal Greg Fergus. There's a pattern there with Liberals and their inability to follow the ethics guidelines of this place. We saw opposition from the government to, instead of having transparency and just addressing the issue head on, it's been pronounced on by an independent officer of parliament. They don't want that kind of transparency. They don't want to talk about their trade ministering who gave sweetheart deals to her bestie worth tens of thousands of dollars. But every time we say their names, say, oh my goodness, you can't say our names. As if we're responsible for the actions of people outside of this place. And let me be crystal clear that when people engage with elected officials, like when you engage with your neighbor, because that's what parliamentarians are, we're members of a community, we're someone's family, we're somebody's neighbors. I sincerely hope that people don't walk out their front door and scream profanities at their neighbors. And I would expect the same when they're expressing they're expressing themselves to elected officials. But I won't say that people shouldn't express themselves. It's, of course, our right as Canadians to do that. But we are part of a society, and we need to make sure that we do it in such a way that, are we looking for dialogue, or are we just simply looking to intimidate someone? Now, screaming expletives at someone, I would say, that could serve as intimidation, and that's not acceptable. And that's why we have rules in this place. We of course, don't do that. But putting forward motions that are germane to the issues that our committee is dealing with, that's not intimidation. When we're dealing with foreign interference, questions of foreign interference at the Standing Committee on Access to Information, Privacy, and Ethics, and when there is national media about, with judges speaking about allegations of election interference in specific ridings, and the government decides to put a member who is from one of those ridings on a committee that's dealing with that study, should we just not talk? We can't talk about Steveston Richmond East because the member for Steveston Richmond East is on the committee. So we'll talk about foreign interference that may or may not have affected Steveston Richmond East in the next after the next election. And we'll just hope, because the NDP don't want to see expeditious passage of foreign interference legislation that would help us combat that by foreign state actors like the dictatorship in Beijing. We'll just hope that it doesn't reoccur. That's absurd. We have an obligation as members to create a space where we can actually do our job without finding ourselves in an area that could be a conflict. And if there's that perception of a conflict, or if the individual feels like they might be conflicted, it hits a little too close to home, well, maybe they should come and give witness testimony and not be questioning the witnesses. When we have an individual who comes before a committee who alleges that the riding that they held as an elected member and then lost in an election, that the individual that they lost to is examining their evidence in the meeting, I would just expect that all individuals involved from all parties who ran, including the individual who won in any of those questionable or writings that are in question, would appear as witnesses and wouldn't cross-examine the other individuals who are alleging, in some cases, that members were elected in part because of foreign interference tactics by state actors. So we find ourselves in a problem, in a situation that I feel like could have been avoided. But all members, when we have a full complement of 338 who are elected, we'll have 343 after the next election, are associate members of all of the standing committees of the House. And then we have regular members. I know people say permanent member. No one's a permanent member. But members can attend any committee meeting. And even members from parties who are not from parties who have recognized standing on the committee, independent members, they can attend. They just can't vote. And two non-regular members of the standing committee from the official opposition attended, they are able to sit at the table, they're able to make interventions, they are able to question witnesses, they're able to raise points of order. They're not able to vote unless a substitution has been made to the clerk. And if a regular member of the committee is in the room, they can't be substituted in voting for that member, even if a substitution request has been made to the clerk. And it's surprising. I have not been here for a long time. I've been elected for a little over 5 years, elected in December of 2018. But I know the rules. And even the other day, I had a Liberal parliamentary secretary challenge that I was able to question one of their ministers, interrupted my questioning of a minister. Is he even allowed to be here? Is he allowed to ask questions? I'm counting enough conservatives at the table. All the regular members are there. He can't really be allowed to ask a minister, a cabinet minister, questions. Imagine that Leeds Grenville sent their man to Ottawa, and he was able to ask a Liberal cabinet minister questions and hold him accountable. Of course I can. And of course we're going to do that. I heard it from a different parliamentary secretary in the House during debate who challenged to the Speaker my ability to ask a question that wasn't on the prepared notes that he got from his minister in an adjournment proceeding. It's absurd. It's absurd that the NDP Liberal government thinks that the official opposition is going to sit quietly while they run roughshod over our democracy and over Canadians. We were sent here to represent Canadians, to represent our constituents, but also to represent the interests of people from across our great country. And after 9 years of the NDP Liberal government, a lot of Canadians are frustrated and upset, and a lot of them are lined up at food banks in record numbers. A lot of them are worried about being able to pay their mortgage or their rent. A lot of them are struggling to access the health care that they need. A lot of them are seeing drugs and disorder on the streets that they couldn't have imagined 9 years ago. And we're going to come here every single day, and we are going to hold this NDP Liberal government to account. We're going to challenge them. And if they cobble enough votes together with other parties, well, such is democracy. And people will ask, will you raise that issue? And you demonstrated at committee, or you demonstrated in the House, that the government failed, or they broke the rules, in some cases broke the law. Well, what's the consequence? Well, in a democracy, the consequences come from voters at the ballot box. And so our job is the exposition of corruption and failure after 9 years of Justin Trudeau and his NDP Liberal government. That's what we're going to do. We're going to expose it. And then in the next election, which is probably going to come a little later than most would hope, because the leader of the NDP, Mr. Singh, is really holding on for that pension, Canadians are going to cast their ballot, and they're going to decide. And in the meantime, we're going to move motions. We're going to move motions that are germane to the work of the standing committees that we sit on. And sometimes we're going to move motions at standing committees that we're associate members of, even if the parliamentary secretaries don't like it, even if the Prime Minister's office doesn't like it, because it's our job. And like that's our job, we have a motion in front of us from Mr. Baines that makes allegations. And I mean, I would encourage him to hold up a mirror when you talk about tactics that are attempting to silence people, because it looks to me that, in fact, what he is doing is exactly what he is alleging that Mr. Brock has done. It's a vexatious attempt to silence critics of a corrupt government. And conservatives will not abide it. Thank you, Chair.